Without good training data, there is no AI. We often get fascinated by the use case and the implications of that. At the end of the day, the use case can only be executed if we have the right data.
Ashim Bose said it best. In order to capture a phenomena, the right instrument in the right space has to be configured in the right direction. The transportation industry lies at a crossroads. Looking for direction and needing guidance, it's in need of instruments to light the way. The light at the end of the proverbial tunnel is coming. That light includes digital transformations, big data, artificial intelligence, and machine learning. But as those techniques and buzzwords converge, how are all of those individual components going to be used? How are they going to be used in industries like transportation? Today, every facet of the transportation industry is changing. Logistics are what gets things from point A to point B, and we need a logistics industry that runs smoothly and on time in order to have a healthy economy. Like many industries, transportation is one where AI is disrupting everything. Ashim is one of the catalysts leading the way. As the chief data scientist and vice president of AI, machine learning, and data at Omnitrax, Ashim oversees the data, machine learning, and AI offerings at scale. Today, Ashim joins me to talk about his past endeavors working on the Hubble Space Telescope, the importance of harnessing the vast amounts of readily available data, and how data will be used for good in the future. Let's jump into today's episode of Hidden in Plain Sight with Ashim Bose.
This season of Hidden in Plain Sight is brought to you exclusively by our friends at Splunk, the Data to Everything platform. Splunk helps organizations worldwide turn data into doing. It's time for data to be more than a record of what happened. It's time to make things happen. Learn more at splunk.com or by clicking the link in our show notes.
Ashim, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Great to be here.
I'm excited to talk to you today. It's not often that we have a chief data and AI officer on the show, and we are excited to get your perspective on everything that's going on with data on the front lines. And also, I'm pretty excited to get back to some of the starts and origins of your career, where you've done some fascinating work on things like the Hubble telescope. So let's jump into it.
Looking forward to it.
So Ashim, when people ask, what do you do now and where do you work? How do you usually respond?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I'm currently at Omnitrax. We are a trucking solutions provider. And basically, we help our customers in the trucking industry with managing their day-to-day operations in terms of routes, plans, schedules, monitoring where their vehicles are, and providing them value-added services around workflows, around compliance, around efficiency, productivity, safety. My job at Omnitrax is to harness the vast amounts of data we collect as a result of all the things I mentioned and more, and essentially apply data science, AI, ML as appropriate, and provide value-added offerings back to our customers. As a recent example, with the pandemic hitting, we very quickly pivoted to providing our customers with health-based alerts to help them figure out where the high-risk areas within the country were and what precautions were needed as they entered or exited that area, and also what type of amenities were open when things were shut down in terms of places to eat and so on and so forth. So that's a recent example of something we did.
Right. And just to give our listeners some perspective kind of on the industry and Omnitrax position there, you're kind of going after the holy grail in the 3PL space, where you're matching carriers with shippers and trying to do this better and better and better. Could you tell us a little bit about this and what the mission is of Omnitrax as a company?
Yeah, our mission at the end of the day is to help our customers find their direction. And basically what that means is, our customers have, day-to-day needs, around the operations, around the customer service, and around safety and so on and so forth. So at the end of the day, we are providing a fair amount of value in terms of not only the enabling the various items I just mentioned, but also helping them integrate with other systems upstream, transportation management systems, ERP systems, supply chain systems. As you mentioned, the holy grail is to have, you know, an end-to-end optimized value chain. And we're definitely, you know, looking at it from that perspective and focused on how do we leverage the data, how do we help our customers get to that, you know, optimized view within their segments, if you will, that can, at the end of the day, result in top and bottom line impact in terms of their business.
Sure. And let's rewind for a little bit. So how did you first get involved in the technology data space? And how did you start learning about machine learning and all of these things?
Yeah, I'm a lifer, forced to admit it. So the whole space of data, analytics, AI has been something that I've been fascinated with ever since I was in grad school many years ago, and ended up getting a PhD in AI. My first job was, working on the Hubble Space Telescope planning and scheduling systems. So, you know, I found this whole space to be extremely interesting. When you think about it, in our day-to-day lives, we are taking in a lot of data through our sensory mechanisms, and we are processing it and acting on it. And so in some ways, we're trying to mimic nature here in terms of what we do. To me, that is extremely fascinating.
I completely agree with that. There's a couple of books on my shelf about biomimetics, and it's a field that's still in its infancy, but it's so exciting to watch. When you were working on the Hubble telescope, what type of data were you using and how were you going about that job there? Could you tell us a little bit about it?
Yeah, absolutely. So I was more on the upstream side of things. So more helping the astronomers plan and schedule their observations on the telescope. The telescope has a number of different instruments and they have various configurations. And the complexity there is, you know, these, as the telescope goes around the Earth in its orbit, to capture the right phenomena in space, the right instrument in the right configuration has to be pointed in the right direction. And just think of all the different observations that have to be captured. And these are all requests from astronomers around the globe in terms of getting some time on the telescope to do what they need to do. So it's a very complex problem in terms of the different configurations for the different instruments, the different directions that the phenomena are occurring, and the telescope needing to be pointed in the right direction. And above all, the need to optimize the energy as the telescope, you know, is configured and rotated to point in the right direction, if you will, because that chews up energy. And as you know, energy is at a premium up there because the only source of energy is are the solar panels that capture the sun's rays. And that's only for part of the day, because the rest of the day, the telescope is in Earth's shadow and so on and so forth. So energy is at a premium. So given all of these constraints, and the data in terms of the requests from astronomers worldwide to, which is in a lot of detail in terms of what they need. So to be able to absorb that, optimize the telescope configurations, and plan and schedule the observations is the problem that me and my team are focused on. And we were using AI and ML techniques for optimization and constraints, capturing the constraints and adhering to the constraints as part of the optimization to be able to do that.
Very cool. And so now it's, you know, almost three decades later. Do you still keep in touch with anyone on the project, or, you know, do you check in from time to time?
Yeah, there is a certain level of curiosity and, you know, a connection, if you will, to, you know, this very, very cool, you know, project that I was privileged to be a part of. And yeah, I do keep up with my former colleagues, and, you know, some of them have moved on and some are still working on other space programs. I think it's safe to say that the Hubble is more in maintenance mode, and it's kind of outlived anyone's expectations in terms of its tenure, productive tenure up in the sky. But yeah, you know, there were a lot of learnings that came out even for the team that I was a part of, and those have been applied to other programs down the road.
When it came to your next venture after working on the Hubble, where did you go and how did the learnings there kind of come with you? What was the next step for you?
So after that, I went to Verizon Labs. At the time, it was called GTE Labs. Verizon ended up acquiring GTE many years ago. This was in the telco sector. And the focus there was on basically, again, applying AI ML techniques to diagnosing network issues basically executing on fixes before they became major disruptions. So that was also a use case that was very much, predictive, prescriptive in nature. And that was what I was fascinated with. I wanted to use my learnings from the Hubble project to apply to more a commercial use case. And this provided me a great opportunity to do that.
So Ashim, you're also a prolific writer when it comes to data, ML, and talking about, you know, the different changes in the automotive space. Have you always been a writer? Is this something that you've done throughout your career? I'm curious about when did that start and what's that been like for you?
I have definitely, you know, had a proclivity to writing, and early on it used to be more essays and stories back in school, and, you know, over time that became papers and things like that in academia. Of course, you know, when you're in grad school, when you're getting your PhD in the academic world, there's a bit of a publish or perish mindset, as you may have heard of. And so, there was a lot of encouragement from my professors, from my thesis advisor and so on to write and publish and, you know, obviously in a meaningful, insightful manner. So that was definitely something that I've had, you know, as an underlying theme throughout my career, and continue to find opportunities to do that.
One of the articles you wrote is about how data will drive the transportation industry in 2020. And I'm just curious, you know, because of your role at OmniTrax and all of the information that you are privy to, what do you see going on at the front lines of the logistics space? Is there anything that is really exciting there that the industry still hasn't fully grasped? What's your take there?
So there are a lot of exciting things going on for sure. The amount of data we, you know, have access to continues to grow exponentially as, you know, we have more sensors, devices, cameras, at the edge, as we call it. And so the volumes continue to increase, not only the collection point, but also the technologies that move the data from point A to point B. Things like 5G are becoming more prevalent, if you will. What that is going to drive is basically a few different things in terms of the industry. Obviously we're going to see, you know, continuous improvements on use cases around safety and productivity and so on as the increased volumes and diversity of data leads to better algorithms to, you know, diagnose issues, to predict accidents, predict breakdowns before they actually happen, and help our customers, take remedial action, if you will. The other piece is the, you know, the connected supply chain that we touched upon earlier, which is going to get more and more prevalent. The third area is around autonomous. Not saying that autonomous, you know, fully autonomous is going to come anytime, you know, soon in the next couple of years. But the vehicles will continue to get more and more ADAS features, as they are called, advanced driving assistance system features. And these will, you know, help our customers be more productive, be safer, and so on and so forth. So the whole topic of AI at the edge, which will drive a lot of this, will continue to grow, if you will.
When you think about the convergence of some of the things you mentioned, like 5G, like these ADAS systems, and, you know, we're not at level five, we might not be for who knows how long, but as we start to get closer to it, and, you know, 5G comes into play, sensors get better at the edge, what type of world or what type of improvements in the transportation industry could we expect to see? Is there anything that an outside consumer might notice? Kind of walk us through what might happen over the next 5, 10, 15 years.
I would say that, you know, in terms of ADAS, as we see smarter devices deployed at the edge, in this case, in the cabs, in the trailers, and so on, that helps with you know, things like safety, safer driving. It helps with insurance. You know, that in the trucking industry, insurance is a huge deal. On average, customers spend approximately $175,000 per accident, if you will. So huge deal. So any improvements we can make to make a day in the life safer and reduce the number of accidents can be significant. Similarly, fuel costs are a big part of the operational costs for the trucking industry. And even a decimal point savings in fuel efficiency can have a huge impact on the bottom line. So think about smarter devices at the edge helping our customers improve their routing efficiency, helping them improve, you know, finding ways to bypass traffic jams and, you know, other construction and, you know, other similar delays can have a huge impact to their bottom line. Also identifying and helping them locate problem areas on the roadways. As we get more data, we are able to pinpoint what the problem areas are where we see a high frequency of events, critical events as they're called, you know, over-speeding, collisions, rollovers, things like that. You know, as we all know, as we're all drivers, at the end of the day, there are always some problem areas where, you know, it's better to, you know, plan ahead or try to bypass, if you will, if there is an option to do that. So being able to locate those ahead of time, being able to, you know, have a plan, whether it's, you know, additional time or an alternative route, et cetera, can have an impact in terms of customer service, in terms of timely deliveries, in terms of fuel efficiency, in terms of safety, and so on. So these are some examples of things that, you know, are going to impact the day-to-day life, not to mention, you know, the connected supply chain where, you know, if a customer, you know, in this industry, it's really important to have strong service levels, customer service levels, to be able to deliver goods in the prescribed window. And the accuracy in doing that can be huge in terms of customer satisfaction, in terms of repeat business, and so on. Think about it. You know, people are transporting perishables. I think, you know, in some cases, as many as 50 to 60% of the goods transported are perishables, especially when you think about the restaurants, grocery stores, and school cafeterias that are just opening up again, and so on and so forth. So it's really important to be able to do this in a timely manner. And the technologies we're talking about willing to help do that. Another area that, you know, is a really, you know, interesting area. When you think about trucking and think about deliveries, the deliveries are not usually made to the front of the address that you're delivering to. The docking area is usually in the back, right? And sometimes, depending on the size of the vehicle, the route from the front to the back of the same building could be fairly complicated.
Right. Fitting in the vehicle. It's a potential problem where it could take extra hours to get in the vehicle. You don't know if it's clear, if there's anything blocking the way. So, yeah.
Absolutely. So being able to figure that out ahead of time based on the digital signatures we capture, you know, and helping our customers get to the back in a more optimized manner can be, again, significant savings in terms of time, in terms of fuel, as well as improvement in terms of customer service. So those are some examples of, you know, how the day-to-day is impacted with the tremendous amounts of data and the algorithms we can leverage.
Sure. Ashim, where do you see the future of C-level positions for data scientists, for AI researchers, for folks that are focused on, you know, machine learning, AI? Do you see a convergence here where there's going to be one singular title? Do you think for the next couple of years, there will be just, you know, many different titles that incorporate these phrases? Is there any type of, you know, singular C-suite position you see all of this evolving into?
That's an interesting question. I see multiple titles in the C-suite owning this area. In some cases, it's the CIO. In some cases, it's the CTO. In some cases, it's the chief data officer. In other cases, it's the chief data scientist, chief AI officer. So I think these are some of the titles that we'll continue to see owning this space. As things get more mature, there is definitely an opportunity to consolidate and have, you know, a singular title that, you know, represents this space, if you will. But I don't see that happening in the next 3 to 5 years because there's still a lot of curiosity, experimentation, dipping your toes in the water type stuff going on. And as those results start to bear fruit and companies realize how strategic this function is, we'll see more focus in making it consolidated and giving it the right importance in the C-suite, if you will.
Right. And so for any of the roles that we just mentioned, or, you know, for your own role, I would be curious to know about what the learning routine is like. So, you know, are you looking to academic papers? Are you listening to podcasts, talking with peers? Is it a mix of all of these things? How are you going about figuring out, you know, what's on the bleeding edge of AI research or machine learning as it applies to your work?
It's a great question. You know, there are multiple sources to monitor, and that can be a challenge because, you know, typically the days are full of meetings and updates and so on and so forth, which, you know, is basically a day in the life as you go up the chain, if you will. Having said that, we all have to kind of figure out, to carve out the time, whether it's in our spare time or part of the workday and so on, to be able to monitor the various blogs, the sites, the social media, and the influencers and some of the publications. Obviously, technology helps here as well. So, you know, there are apps you can download that, you know, you put in the keywords and, or you can put in, you know, the keywords in the search engine and have it run every day or whatever the frequency you need it to be, and still have a pretty good pulse on the various advancements, the topics that are being discussed. Of course, we all have our pet areas within our domain that we, you know, kind of dig deeper into. In my case, you know, it's the transportation industry, it's the automotive industry, it's the whole autonomous field. These are all extremely near and dear to me. So I obviously take an extra effort to make sure I'm up to speed on the latest in that space.
Sure. And when it comes to building, you know, a company like Omnitrax and building your team internally, how are you going about doing this? And are there any philosophies that you've developed over the years when it comes to finding, recruiting, and retaining key machine learning experts, data experts? Are there any insights there you have to share?
The space is highly competitive. It's no secret that it's very difficult to find the right skills at the right time. And so, you know, I've worked with some really good people, you know, developed a strong network and know strengths and weaknesses and so on. So, you know, I'm able to tap into the network and, you know, leverage it that way. Other than that, you know, it is, it's extremely important to have a connection to some of the universities and the talent that they are producing, and, you know, engage with them in multiple ways in terms of projects that, you know, can be done as part of the graduate programs, as, you know, engage them as interns in some cases, just kind of feel each other out in terms of strengths and where the synergies might lie. And then also leverage some of the traditional mechanisms in terms of specialized recruitment, where, you know, relying on people who know the space, who have, you know, been in the space a long time as recruiters. And so, you know, relying on people like that can also be helpful.
For sure. And if you are, you know, looking out again, if you put on that 15-year view for the space, for 3PL, for AI as it impacts all of our transportation needs, what do you think is going to be most surprising, or are there any developments that you're on your edge of your seat waiting to, you know, discover? There's, you know, recently GPT-3 was released, and I don't know how relevant NLP and things like that are to your space, but are there any developments like that as it relates to transportation that researchers are eagerly anticipating?
Yeah, in terms of transportation, the smarter devices is going to continue to be a trend, and that'll, you know, continue to help in terms of productivity, safety, efficiency. The autonomous will also continue to become more and more meaningful. And what that means is it allows people in the cab to be more productive, to do tasks up the value chain, if you will, in terms of deliveries, customer satisfaction, and, you know, able to improve the quality of all of that. The connectedness will obviously be very helpful in terms of visibility in the supply chain of where things are at. The whole space around having what you need when you need it is going to continue to grow. And companies like Amazon are doing a great job of leading the way on that front. And I see that becoming more and more prevalent. It was in the news recently about the drones and how they're going to impact delivery as well. So that trend, the last mile delivery, we're going to see more and more use of that as we look ahead 20 years, 15, 20 years for sure. And of course, there's going to be a need for very strong regulatory measures to accommodate for all of this. So I definitely see a need for the, you know, regulations to be put in place to be able to do all of this in an effective way without causing any major issues, if you will.
Sure. And when it comes to the space, are there any examples of specific data sets that are maybe just now starting to be collected that, you know, where you're very eager for them to be collected on a wider scale to help solve a specific problem? Or are there, you know, any examples of new data that you're collecting now that you're applying to your central models in order to make everything better in the space?
Yeah. So, you know, an example of this is video, right? So the latest cameras are able to capture events inward-facing cameras can help diagnose fatigue, you know, distracted driving, you know, which is significant in terms of safety. So that leads to opportunities to not only improve safety, but also improve coaching, you know, in terms of the do's and don'ts while you're on the road and things like that. So that's an example of a relatively new set of data that the industry is leveraging. Another example is around, you know, basically being able to apply AIML to predict delays, to predict effective routes, so on, ahead of time, if you will. You know, Google and other companies in this space are kind of leading the way in terms of consumer traffic and, you know, helping navigate roadways and so on. But this is going to become extremely important for us as well as we move forward, being able to do that based on the vast amounts of data we now have access to, not only within our own customer base, but in terms of publicly available data that we can also leverage. So these are some examples of new data sets.
Sure. And Sheen, thank you for being generous with your time. This has been awesome. Final question here, and then I'll let you run. What is the most important lesson that you've learned throughout your career? You know, what do you find yourself reflecting on from time to time, or what do you find yourself sharing with colleagues or direct reports? Could be one thing, could be two, but I'm just curious to know if you have one specific lesson that you reflect on from time to time.
In my space, one of the fundamental mantras that I reflect on a lot is without good training data, there is no AI. So we often get fascinated by the use case and the implications of that. At the end of the day, the use case can only be executed if we have the right data or figure out a way to get it. And to me, that's something that keeps coming up over and over and over throughout my career. It's very basic and fundamental, but you know, sometimes we forget about it as we go about our day to day and get, you know, all wrapped up in the next new use case or application of AI ML algorithms and so on.
Wise words, and smart to make that a mantra and reflect on it. So Sheen, thank you so much for joining us, and to everyone listening, we'll see you next time.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure.
I'm Sophia Bush, and you've been listening to Hidden in Plain Sight from Mission.org. This podcast is sponsored by our friends at Splunk, the Data to Everything platform. In today's data-driven world, every company, big or small, new or old, is sitting on terabytes of unused, untapped, and unknown data. Splunk helps turn all that data into action. Using cutting-edge AI and machine learning, Splunk delivers real-time predictive insights that will help you on your mission to change the world. With solutions for IT, security, Internet of Things, and business operations, Splunk empowers people to make faster, better decisions and take action to get things done. It's time for our data to be more than a record of what happened. It's time to make things.